Welcome everyone to episode 21 of Beyond the Ropes.
I'm Ethan.
I'm Rob.
Interesting weekend. We had this big football game yesterday. Did you watch?
No.
I did. The reason I'm discussing it is because there was some interesting news over the weekend. Ric Flair was supposed to be in a commercial, Super Bowl commercial, promoting this kind of dealership, and apparently it was banned for whatever reason. I believe there was some wording in it that the Super Bowl didn't want. Wow. So it ultimately got banned. But yeah, Ric Flair was supposed to be in a Super Bowl commercial.
I remember there was rumors like a year or two ago that supposedly he wanted to buy into that team from his from North Carolina.
The Panthers, I think?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Carolina Panthers. Yeah, I know Ric Flair has been in kind of that football world the last couple of years. He's been giving pep talks to a number of the teams over the years. But yeah, he was supposed to be in that commercial. The Patriots caught up and ended up winning the Super Bowl. As of this morning or late last night, Triple H tweeted out a picture of the WWE title with the Patriots logo on it and saying he was going to send it to them. So congratulations. That's some wrestling news related to the Super Bowl there. What else happened over the weekend? Let's see. Oh, just about an hour or two ago, we got some breaking news from WWE announcing their next Hall of Fame inductees in the 2017 class. The Rock and Roll Express. Now, the Rock and Roll Express, longtime tag team. They're still wrestling today, I believe. If I'm not mistaken, they were in the Final Deletion or Total Nonstop Deletion against the Hardys in a very cool, funny segment. And so, I mean, good for them. Tag team that is going in this year, very well deserved. I believe they're still wrestling in the indies, so that's very cool to see. Do we have any viewers checking in? We're live on Periscope. Remember, we're live on Periscope Mondays.
Got some live people already.
Mondays and Wednesdays around 11. We like to go live on Periscope. Search up Cerritos College. And you'll see our wrestling-based Periscope. And so, let me look up... Because we had an episode of Impact Wrestling this past week.
Yeah, that was really something.
Absolutely. Let me look that
it's
up.
It's something
right
how
now.
Moose keeps trying to challenge for the belt, but now he's like, Drew is like dodging him.
I did not see this past week's, so I'm a little behind, but I'm working on it. Definitely have to watch that because it's been interesting the last couple of weeks. They've been rebuilding the brand, and so I know that they're trying to do that. So it was Open Fight Night, right?
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken. So let's get into those results for Impact Open Fight Night. The first Open Fight Night in a couple of years. It made its return this past Thursday at the Impact Zone in Orlando, Florida. Jeff Hardy used the first of the four race to the case briefcases in the opener, unsuccessfully challenging Lashley for the TNA title. How was the match? Did you watch it?
Yeah, but I just think it was a wasted opportunity. I mean, why didn't he choose like a ladder or something?
It was just a regular match, it wasn't...
Yeah, I mean, he just...
He could have chosen a stipulation, right?
He landed wrong doing a high-flying move, and he was able to take advantage afterwards in the ring and go for a spear, so...
Okay. Well, it's very unusual why he wouldn't want a ladder match.
Plus, he told Matt to go to the back, so I thought that sucked.
I guess he wanted to do it on his own, so... unfortunately, unsuccessful. Afterwards, the former champion, Eddie Edwards, challenged Lashley to a rematch, which Lashley accepted. Did anything else happen of that in the night, or if it? No, nothing.
No, I mean.
So we'll probably see that this week, some aftermath of that.
Yeah, because everybody, once they fight, they only fought that one time.
Okay.
You can't re-challenge someone.
That's right. Okay. So, Brandi Rhodes made an appearance, obviously the wife of Cody, where she reviewed...
Are you a Reigns fan?
A Reigns fan?
I mean, maybe when he was in the Shield, because the Shield itself was a unit, but...
I like Reigns. I'm not a big fan, but I would like to see him succeed. Maybe a little change of character. Maybe a heel turn, which we may see. I got some news, speaking of Roman Reigns, I got some news about that over the weekend, which we can discuss in a bit after the results. But yeah, I'm not opposed to him. So anyways, Brandi Rhodes refused Rosemary's offer to join Decay, in which Rosemary threatened Brandi. So how did that segment go? We got a comment.
What news?
Stay tuned. We're going to discuss the news about Roman Reigns and his spot at the Royal Rumble. So, how did that segment, was it?
That one I don't remember.
Okay, so it wasn't really memorable. Okay, well, there's story building there, so we'll see how it goes. Sienna defeated Brooke Testmacher by pinfall with a silencer after Maria Kanellis interfered. So they're obviously doing this feud with Brooke and Maria, I assume. How was the match?
It was decent. Like I said, the distractions, that's the only reason why she won. It's funny, I didn't realize that Sienna used that move to pay homage to the Alpha Male.
That's right. Spear. Okay, yeah, he uses that move. A couple of people use that move, actually. I think Mojo Rawley uses that move, too. I don't know if, as a finisher, but he uses it. So the DCC used their second of the four briefcases.
That was probably the best match.
To defeat Decay on a 2-on-3 Falls Count Anywhere match, where James Storm pinned Crazy Steve with a pile driver through a table.
Best match.
That sounded like it would be a good match.
Yeah, thumbtacks on the table, on the...
that's crazy.
The ring, they threw a Kingston on it. Broke a beer bottle on Abyss. Threw him on a board of barbed wire.
Jeez. Yeah. So, like, a typical kind of Abyss match, pretty much, a Decay match. I'm surprised they wouldn't use that. Oh, okay, so that makes sense. Because I'm trying to think, why wouldn't they use it for the tag team titles? But then Jeff already had a match. So they couldn't challenge him. So, okay, that makes sense.
I was a little disappointed with this whole concept of these briefcases. I thought everybody... Well, at least it's not totally stealing what Feast or Fire is for, then. But yeah. At least make them specialty-type matches, not just normal one-on-one
I would think
matches.
That they would kind of spread out the briefcases and do it like an actual cash-in.
Yeah.
Like the Money in the Bank briefcases. But that match sounded interesting, so I've definitely got to check that out.
They did try to focus also on like the fact that like it doesn't matter if you're not medically cleared.
Oh, wow, really?
They'll go after you no matter what. It's just like EC3, they went after him, and apparently he had a purple bruise on his abdomen.
Oh, okay. So we'll get that. We'll get to that. That's the main event, I believe, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so there was an angle where Maria demanded that Braxton Sutter propose to Laurel Van Ness, continuing to blackmail him. That appears to be the only segment there. What do you think? What do you think about that storyline?
They should just reveal what it is already. Otherwise, they're kind of like dragging the storyline too much.
Yeah, I mean, they've been doing that for a little while. So, I mean, it's weird how she's in multiple kind of storylines. Maria, she's in this thing with Brooke Testmacher, but at the same time, she's kind of blackmailing Braxton Sutter. And she's kind of like pulling the strings on a lot of these.
I guess she's making up for lost time when she was in WWE television, just being a dimwit. Her I gimmick.
Guess. Pretty much. Yeah, she's a force to be reckoned with here in Impact Wrestling. The Impact Grand Championship was on the line where Drew Galloway easily defended his title against local talent Rob Ryzen with the Future's Shock DDT after ducking a challenge by Moose. So you mentioned this earlier, Drew Galloway was ducking a challenge by Moose. So did Moose come up first and challenge him? Or
No, he was. He told everyone that he had a challenger, and he'd open up for anybody that wants a shot. And Moose came out. He's like, "No, not you."
Oh wow! Okay, so anyone but Moose, pretty much. So Trevor Lee used a third of the fourth race to the case briefcase to become the new TNX division champion, defeating the injured DJZ to win the title in a ladder match. So that makes sense. Why we didn't see a ladder match earlier in the night. I saw this, Trevor Lee winning the title, last week. It was kind of expected after the attack on DJZ. And DJZ obviously injured knee, right?
Yeah, he continued going on that knee with the chair.
So that makes sense as to why that was a ladder match. A smart strategy. That was actually, seems like a very good use of the case. And now Trevor Lee is once again X Division champion. So, okay, how was the match itself?
It was pretty great as far as, like, maybe you want to write off someone from, like,
mm-hmm. That's what I would think. Mm-hmm. Well, they need to try and rebuild that X Division because it's been a few years since it's been really healthy. And we've seen a couple people come and go every few years. And so I think they need to work on that.
You know, with some people coming back every now and then, like, mm-hmm. No, he announced his retirement a while back, I think. Petey Williams, that would have been something. See one more Canadian Destroyer. That move.
Yeah, that was a devastating finisher. Yeah. But yeah, we'll have to see where this X Division goes now that Trevor Lee is the X Division champion. Robbie E crashes a day in the life segment of Aaron Rex, where Rex and Rockstar Spud were challenged to a match next week. With them fleeing, so I like this Aaron Rex character, the new kind of Liberace style character with Rockstar Spud by his side, and it seems like Robbie E is getting into this singles feud with them. They've been doing this the last couple of weeks, so we'll be looking forward to that this week.
You know, I thought that at first when he did have the grand championship for a little while, mm-hmm. that he was going to continue with that heel tactic where he had this towel and for some reason whatever was on the towel, he'd go like that to the eyes of the opponent, and they were blind for throughout the match.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody else, I think, has done that.
Not that I can remember, yeah. So, moving to the main event, Eli Drake uses the final case and loses to EC3, which is a bit disappointing. When EC3 beat him with the jackknife pin, afterwards, Drake and Tyrus attacked EC3, and then the DCC run down and lay everyone out to close the show. So it appears the DCC is getting a big push. You know, they started off pretty strong, and then they kind of, after losing to the Hardys, they kind of fell a little bit. Now that it seems like they're building them up again. How was the match between Eli Drake and EC3?
Well, it was just like a squash pretty much for a while, but that DDC, they laid all three of them down, so it'll be interesting to see them work together, even though they don't really get along with EC3, in order to take on the DCC.
Yeah, absolutely. So, solid episode, I guess, right? Yeah. I have to catch up on that. But as you mentioned, that false kind of underwear match seems to be interesting, that ladder match, too. So let's see what else we've got over this weekend. So I'm gonna explain why Roman Reigns was in the Rumble apparently. excuse me. So I'm reading this off WrestlingNews.com. For those of you wondering why Roman Reigns was slotted in the number 30th entrant in the Royal Rumble match, it was done with this specific plan in mind. The company knew that fans would react negatively to Reigns, and they knew that Randy Orton would get a big pop for eliminating him. Yes, Orton is a heel right now, but he will eventually turn babyface by the time WrestleMania rolls around, so they were thinking long term when they booked the Rumble match. Also, in the eyes of fans, Reigns is going to be the default heel in his feud with The Undertaker, so there's no reason to go against the grain until the feud is over. Also, for those of you who have asked about a potential Reigns heel turn, Don't hold your breath on that because Reigns is still pegged to be the long-term babyface for the company. While Reigns is booed at the pay-per-views and TV tapings, he is still cheered at the live events. The live events consist of families taking their kids out, and they are still buying his merchandise. It's one of the main reasons why WWE has been reluctant to turn John Cena. He gets a reaction from everyone, positive and negative, and that's what they are looking for, and his merchandise sales are hard to deny. So pretty much don't expect the Roman Reigns heel turn. He'll be a default heel when he feuds with The Undertaker, which apparently is going to happen at WrestleMania. Thoughts on that?
Well, the fans just haven't been able to get behind him as much every time he's been a babyface. Like, they figure, oh man, well, you're related to The Rock, so we figured they're going to just put the belt on you just because of that. I mean, the Usos have proven themselves. They're mm-hmm. very athletic, and they're very unique to the tag division. Mm-hmm. But Roman, I think the problem with him, though, has been his mic skills. Their faith in him hasn't been that great.
I think Roman needs to do a lot of just being... Well, I can't really say this on the radio, but being a really tough guy, pretty much say. Take those beatings, take those, you know, he was getting cheered when he won the WWE titles for the first time, when he was again feuding against Triple H, and Vince was there, and he won the title from Sheamus on Monday night. He got cheered, and he was getting cheered for a couple of weeks because he was dominant. It was the TLC pay-per-view where he absolutely destroyed Triple H, and everyone was cheering him there. He needs to go back to that, just being an absolute monster. And so I think that's what will do him well. However, going against The Undertaker, that's not going to work. Especially when Undertaker is battling some hip injury, just had surgery. Going to need a hip replacement at some point after he retires. So it's going to be interesting how they work that storyline and that feud.
He should have just got it reoperated, never competed in the Rumble.
But no, he did have the surgeries.
It wasn't that successful then. He's still feeling like something.
Well, I don't know how long his recovery time. That's a thing. He shouldn't have competed in the Rumble, but I guess they just really wanted to make it. They wanted to start building that storyline for him and Reigns. So last week also, Seth Rollins was announced that he had an injury. He got injured by Samoe Joe after a bad landing in the Coquina clutch. Pretty much, luckily for us, the fans, and for Seth, it appears he might make it back in time for Mania. 6 to 8 week recovery. That means he would essentially be, if he were to make it back in 8 weeks, he would make it back literally days before WrestleMania, which is...
There would be no
Fastlane
match, though, with Joe.
No, that's not happening. That's out. That's definitely out. But the Mania match is still a possibility. It's not a guarantee anymore, but it's a possibility. If Seth can come back sooner than 8 weeks, you know, 4 to 6 weeks, then that's more likely, but...
Welcome.
It's likely that we're going to hear something from Triple H this week on Monday Night Raw tonight. So hopefully we'll get to hear what he has to say about the attack. I don't really know what else is next for Triple H if Seth isn't healthy enough. And it's really unfortunate for Seth because he really wanted to be at Mania this year.
I mean, if they just let him heal, unfortunately, you know, there won't be no Triple H storyline with him, but they can...
They're going to have to wait until after.
Good push.
I don't see Shinsuke at Mania this year. Finn is supposed to have something at Mania, whether it's a match or not, but I would be okay with the Finn Triple H match or Finn Joe match. They're supposed to have something big for Joe for Mania. So, I mean, he's on Raw now, so I don't know who he would face. When I think many were speculating he would be on SmackDown. This wasn't really much of a news-heavy weekend. Oh, there was something on the ESPN. Yeah, on ESPN. This was the XFL, so they did a 30 for 30 on WWE's version of the NFL, the XFL. excuse me. And so, yeah, it was a really good documentary. I recommend you check it out. It's probably on YouTube, maybe. I don't know. It just came out on Thursday. Really good details where you had Dick Ebersol, Vince McMahon, Jesse the Body Ventura, and a lot of people involved in the XFL, you know, a couple of the players, a couple of the backstage hands, discussed the process of that, and it was really cool to see how the XFL innovated the NFL, especially, you know, we talked about the Super Bowl briefly earlier. Without the XFL, there would be no, like, those cameras in the middle of the field. There wouldn't be those mics on the referees and on the players. There wouldn't be that up close and personal, really, relationships with the fans. And so the XFL did that.
Obviously, it's funny how harsh the interviewers were with Vince, though, when he created that organization.
They were very harsh. There was one where, what was his name? I believe his name was Bob Costas. He was, and he really gave a tough interview on Vince, and Vince was very fuming at the time. He didn't have a lot of media experience either, and so it was really bad. And unfortunately, you know, the XFL only lasted a season. But at the end of the kind of documentary, Vince and Dick Ebersol, the two creators and partners that brought the XFL to life, were eating dinner, and they teased a return. Obviously, I don't think that's going to happen. Dick Ebersol is retired, and Vince is, you know, really focused on the WWE Network and such. But it was very cool to see that tease and that reunion, because I don't think they've seen each other for a number of years. But it showed a true testament to their partnership and friendship, because they had teamed up years before that. And so it was really cool to see how they put together the XFL. Very cool documentary. I recommend you check that out. So this is going to be interesting. So we're heading into WrestleMania. We're in WrestleMania season. What are we? We're like 57, 56 days away, I believe. So WrestleMania, less than 2 months. Are you looking forward to it? I know I am.
Well, that's going to be really something. I heard that they're outreaching to past female talent.
So you read my mind, because I just clicked on that link.
What's up? Thanks for tuning in.
Thanks for tuning in. Remember, you guys can check us out on Periscope. You can go give us a like on Facebook, Beyond the Ropes. Yes, you read my mind, because I clicked the link. Over the weekend, there was some news that WWE was calling women for WrestleMania, past women talent. It is also rumored that Nikki Bella is considering retirement.
Oh, man, that would be really something, considering that she supposedly, when they introduced the women's title on SmackDown, mm-hmm. that she was like, oh, well, she wants to go ahead and win that one.
Mm-hmm. Well, it may not be likely if she decides to call it a day. But apparently, so a number of tweets were sent out that could be related to this WWE contacting the woman. It could be unrelated, however. But apparently, Kelly, Barbie Blank, as her real name, recently responded to Mickie James's Talking Smack promo with the kind of the 100 emoji. I don't know if you guys know that, the 100 emoji. So basically agreeing with what Mickie James said. Mickie James responded with...
Are you a real wrestler, they said?
I am not, unfortunately.
These are the world broadcasting tag belts.
Yeah, we're...
The broadcasters.
We're tag team champions of the broadcasting world, not the wrestling ring. Mickie James responded to Barbie Blank, Kelly, saying, like, they don't know who we be. I don't fight, I don't argue. And Michelle McCool responded with real talk.
Which one?
Who
said one of them's a joke?
Yeah, who's the joke?
Which wrestler? Which female wrestler?
But anyways,
Mickey James returning.
What do we got? We're live on Periscope, guys. So make sure to check us out. Cerritos College.
Mickey James.
Mickey James is they're calling Mickey James a joke. She's great. I don't know. I completely disagree. That's your opinion. We appreciate everyone's opinions and your contributions to the show. So feel free to state those opinions. And if you have any questions, have any comments you would like to make, feel free to do so. But Mickey James is, they offered her a contract. She's still a great wrestler. She's still a great promo person. So I'm glad to have her back. And hopefully we'll get to see a couple of these formerly known as divas back in the wrestling spotlight for a little while. Any more comments? No.
That we should have our hats off for more indoors.
Oh, it's very cold.
Yeah, it's been raining here. Where are you guys from?
Yeah, it's raining heavily in California, which is very odd to say. But it has been raining and it's pretty cold indoors. And plus you don't want to see my messy hair, so. So we're speaking of upcoming pay-per-views, Fastlane, the Monday Night Raw pay-per-view. No matches have been announced, but apparently this is what's scheduled to happen. So a little spoiler if you don't want to hear this. We're getting more comments. Nothing. Yeah.
No, it's rude. Have a hat.
Oh. Yeah, we apologize. Yeah,
we apologize for our messy hair.
Messy hair and our unconventional ways. But these are likely matches heading into Fastlane. Kevin Owens defending the Universal Champion against Goldberg. So there have been rumors that Goldberg Lesnar is supposed to be for the Universal title in order to up the stakes.
But I heard that they want to keep that match very short.
I'm sure it has to be. Goldberg is not a a wrestler to be
I know, they're just that, they're that amazing.
Oh, they're complimenting their titles.
They're reflecting.
Oh, yeah, that's very cool, yeah.
Yeah, but, the quality, though, and the camcorder, though, because it's better also, though, when you look us up, the episode won't look like the way it is on the phone.
We're on YouTube, right?
Like, on the phone, that's when it's, you see more of that reflection, that's why.
Mm-hmm. We're on YouTube, correct?
Yeah.
Beyond the Rope, search us up.
Just Google it and you'll find.
Roman Reigns is supposed to be taking on Braun Strowman, so that feud is continuing, but it's not going to likely head into WrestleMania with Reigns taking on Taker. Jericho and Zayn are supposed to have a match for the U.S. title, which makes sense after Zayn beat him last week. And Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson are set to be defending the tag titles against Sheamus and Cesaro. So, pretty solid pay-per-view Fastlane. Those are the rumored matches. That does not mean they're official yet. We'll probably be seeing something official tonight when Goldberg appears to accept or decline Lesnar's challenge.
I liked it. They had a commercial of it on SmackDown. The Wyatts get another shot at the tag belts.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
I did not see that. That'll be interesting.
Is Kane still in?
Kane is still wrestling.
Not as much, though.
Not as much. He was not at the Rumble. He hasn't been on SmackDown in a couple of months, so it's unfortunately Kane is not in the spotlight anymore. But he is still around.
There's been talk that he's been interested in having a political career.
Yeah, a couple of people have Booker T. I know wants to run for mayor for Houston, in his home town. The Rock has talked about it.
I haven't watched since the glory days in the 90s. Oh, yeah, those were
late
great 90s, days.
Yeah, the Attitude Era. But
unfortunately, I would say the deaths of certain professional wrestlers that caused controversy led to a change, a big change in the programming, though, of how you saw the entertainment from then compared to now, though.
Yeah, absolutely, and I would have to say that despite storylines maybe being stronger in the Attitude Era, I think the wrestling has greatly improved. I think we've got some of the best wrestlers we've ever had in WWE right now. You talk about AJ Styles, Shinsuke Nakamura, Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn.
Yeah, it's less nudity, less Seth. Hardcore, but more
athleticism. It's more wrestling, more athleticism.
Risk takers, jumpers.
Absolutely. I think, and that's a lot of fun to see.
They still sell the same way like they always did.
What happened?
They still sell their souls like they always did.
Well, I mean, it's in the WWE, you have to travel 300 days a year, so.
But now they have more like drug testing than they did back then.
They are supposed to be healthier. You know, they do take more risks, but they are healthier in that aspect. A lot of guys have been doing CrossFit. A lot of guys stay away from those.
Yeah.
I mean, the
they're bad trying drugs. Their best to protect their image, especially in World Wrestling Entertainment, by making them even have to wear now tap out gear whenever they're out in public.
You know, they have, that's WWE's own merchandise and branding. Thank you for commenting.
What do you think of The Rock's acting?
I like it. I'm a fan of The Rock.
I mean, it's all right. I mean, his biggest role, obviously, would have to be the Fast and Furious franchise.
That franchise, I would say. I mean.
And what, the next one's supposed to be revolving around him?
So movie? I think he's going to probably be the main protagonist, the main hero. Because apparently in those previews, Vin Diesel has become a bad guy.
Wow.
For some strange reason. So we'll have to see. But I like to enjoy The Rock's acting. I support him in whatever he does. I like it when he comes back, cuts a good promo, and, you know, beats up on some people. Maybe we'll see him at Mania this year. It's in Orlando.
They sure do continue milking the Scorpion King after he did the Scorpion King.
They did those remakes, which he wasn't involved in. So, I mean, I don't know how good they were or bad they were.
I mean, those other, the future ones after The Rock, they went straight to DVD, I think.
Yeah, those were straight to DVD. Those did not hit theaters.
What's with the titles? World Broadcasting Tag Belt. So they're broadcasting titles. So in the back, there's actually microphones.
Our names are on there, if you can see. So if you have any questions wondering why Roman Reigns is taking on The Undertaker, Vince wants a passing of the torch. That's,
he's not even a supernatural character or nothing like that. His gimmick. It
but
makes
he wants it, as in Reigns. He wants Taker to endorse Reigns, essentially. Whether he wins or loses, it makes Roman.
It should be AJ Styles.
I don't know. AJ's a little older, though.
Yeah.
Reigns is.
I mean, the matches
30?
That people would like to see with The Undertaker are people that, like, it's like the fans aren't that far behind them. What do you think about other forms of wrestling? Like, what?
What kind of forms of wrestling? I mean, there's different styles. Japan has strong style. There's British strong style. Which
like sumo. Sumo?
Sumo.
Well, I mean, there's been a wrestler before who...
Big Show
was
involved in a sumo match against Aki Bono at WrestleMania 21.
And other styles.
There's lucha wrestling.
Yeah, lucha libre.
Cruiserweight, which is very similar to lucha.
I mean, obviously lots of people want to see hardcore, but the reality is not a lot of promotions are willing to take that risk. You don't, especially in World Wrestling Entertainment being the biggest promotion, you won't see headshots.
Yeah, no, it's very risky, and so, especially with a concussion kind of lawsuit that they're dealing with the number of former superstars trying to sue the WWE for those concussion-related injuries, they're trying to stay away from that.
And then Kurt Angle, you know, we've seen some wrestlers who they've had a background in amateur wrestling. And he was like, what, he had a campaign, because he was bummed out that there was a certain year of Olympics that all of a sudden the committee decided to get rid of amateur wrestling, and he was trying to campaign to bring it back in the Olympics.
What about the forms of war in the martial arts spectrum? Well, I mean, that's UFC. That's a whole different business right there already.
Yeah.
but you got Brock.
You got Brock. You got...
Batista, Bobby
Lashley,
people who are balancing both professional wrestling and MMA careers.
Yeah.
Not on the business side, just the art. Oh, well, I mean, that's amazing. If you look at documentaries with, it turns out Bruce Lee, like, lots of people would consider him the godfather of MMA, and there's some people that debate that.
Absolutely.
But he really mentored so many different people, even from various professions in different sports.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, there's a lot of cross-promotion between MMA and WWE.
Ken Shamrock's gimmick.
Yeah, his gimmick was MMA style. Ronda Rousey, obviously, making a WrestleMania appearance, and likely to have some type of feud at some point.
I know, there's lots of rumors. I don't know what you guys think, but in ESPN, the coach used to work for WWE. He was a personality there. And
Jonathan Coachman, yeah.
Yeah, he recently said that now that she lost, like, what, two cage fights?
Yeah.
He believes that WWE will no longer be interested in her because it's kind of... It's not what they do is rebuild broken stars, but I'd still say she still got an amazing fan base, and
she's
at the end of the day, brings the money.
She's going to bring in the money, regardless.
Yeah.
And I think Stephanie and Triple H are very interested in that. I think it'd be good. Getting any more comments now?
No, not yet. Well, let's see.
Do you realize what I'm... I have no idea... continue, Rob.
Mm-hmm. So, Monday Night Raw's tonight. Joe made his debut last week. Seth is injured. We start heading into WrestleMania season, but we still have Fastlane on the way. What's, any predictions tonight?
A promo? A promo already. It has to be.
I would think so.
No in-ring action, I think, yet. No official... one-on-one sanctioned match yet.
Yeah, I can see them holding off until Fastlane or something. If he has a match, we'll have to wait and see. I mean, it's not going to be against Seth because it's too soon, but...
If he has to take out someone, take out Sammy for a bit. You know how he's always trying to be the underdog and always trying to go for the big people.
Well,
so they attack him and then he
Sammy's going
back
for that U.S. title, though, so I don't think that'll... I don't think he's
technically
in
that. Technically, Sin Cara is still part of it. Oh, there was another Spanish word. Remember, there were some Spanish viewers.
He could just take out someone who's not in the feud right now.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Maybe just the promo will do it. Goldberg is set to return. And with the rumors that he's going to be contending for that Universal title, he could, in addition to accepting Lesnar's challenge, could be going after that Universal title. And so, some things to look forward to. Monday Night Raw. Wonder what kind of matches we're going to get. Nothing really, after the aftermath of the Rumble didn't really leave much happening. So, I think we start heading into Fastlane relatively quickly. Or relatively fast.
We go, like, closer to it because, like, the text is too small. We can't make it any bigger in Periscope, like, to watch it from afar.
Yeah, we're a bit distant. We'll try and get a little closer to our Periscope here. Make sure to check us out, Cerritos College, search us up, and you'll find us there.
Keeping track also, like, demographics as well. And one interesting thing we noted is, you know, we've had fans from all over the world, and we've also had viewers from India as well. Mm-hmm. And, like, one of the things we like to do also is highlight people, facts that, you know, there's been entertainers from all over the world. And starting with India, the great Khali, he's had quite a... interesting career.
Yeah, he has. A very unique individual. He was involved in that Punjabi prison match, that first and only. He dominated The Undertaker at one point in his career. And he used to be a police officer before heading into that profession. He really, a 7-foot giant, really did quite a bit in his career in WWE. I believe now he has his own school. So
yeah, and wasn't there a promotion called King Rocking? Did that have to do with him too? The promotion.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, he really wanted to do a lot for
which
India.
Which is Impact Wrestling, right?
Well, some people from Impact would go over to there.
It was kind of a cross promotion. Right? I believe it was cross promotion.
Yeah. But yeah, the Great Khali, if you guys don't remember who he is, the biggest way to remember is he was in an Adam Sandler movie.
The Longest Yard.
Yeah.
Which was a football movie. We're going back and forth with football this episode, following that Super Bowl aftermath. But yeah, it was a football movie. Goldberg was in it. Stone Cold Steve Austin and Kevin Nash were all in it.
And the Great Khali is one of the rare superstars. There's only a small group of really top athletes.
You know, we talk about him, the Big Show. Braun Strowman is up there.
The Giant Gonzalez.
Giant Gonzalez, Undertaker is there. Kane is up there. Kevin Nash. Shaq, if you want to talk about Shaq and Intermania. But yeah, a number of unique athletes out there.
Yeah.
And
I mean, when you talk about
Andre,
like,
you have to talk about Andre. Getting some comments here in our live Periscope.
Anyways, but yeah, there's lots of Indian descent wrestlers who have really made an impact. And I mean, what Sanjay Dutt, the athleticism that he's had, he made such an impact on the X Division.
For TNA, Impact Wrestling. Absolutely. So yeah, these unique characters, these from all over the world. We talk about different characters. The Cruiserweight Classic had 32 countries represented. And so, you know, the United Kingdom had their own tournament for the title. We mentioned that the winner of that UK tournament, Tyler Bate, made his NXT debut last week. Very successful against Oney Lorcan. So that was really cool to see.
Somebody asked earlier, what's your favorite wrestler? Who's your favorite?
So I mentioned this last week, but my favorite wrestler right now would have to be... It's hard to argue with AJ Styles.
Yeah.
But I've always been a Seth Rollins guy, especially when he turned heel for that first time. Jericho has always been one of my favorites, and Shawn Michaels is like my all-time favorite. So currently on the roster, it'd probably be Seth or...
I think it also varies on, like, if you're asking a tag team.
Shinsuke is really good. And Finn, how could I forget Finn? Like, it's hard to really argue against those guys.
Man, I mean, especially, like, what, favorite faction?
Favorite
NWO.
Faction.
I mean, wow.
I've always been a DX guy. I like
Main
DX.
Event Mafia was awesome,
Evolution
too.
Was really cool for me. I liked Evolution. The Shield.
Of all wrestlers in general...
What was the question?
Like, from not just, like, one promotion, like...
Oh, in general. I mean, I would probably still say the same thing. Kenny Omega is really building his name out there, but I haven't seen any of his matches. I might have seen one or two. But I know he's big around the world. Broken by Hardy is great. The Hardys.
Yeah.
The Broken Hardys are a great tag team.
I mean, from many years, you can imagine the library that Jeff Hardy has built of all his risk-taking.
Absolutely, especially in WWE. Those ladder matches, TLC matches, cage matches, you know, you name it. Favorite wrestler of all time is Shawn Michaels for me. The Rock has always been, like, my favorite promo guy, favorite entertainer.
I mean,
Jericho is a good blend of both.
Yeah.
Dean
Malenko was great with submissions.
He was a good he was a man of 1,000 holds, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And Jericho was a man of 1,004 holds. The original list of Jericho in WCW where he would name all 1,004 holds. He just had more holds than Malenko. and so yeah, so Eddie Guerrero was a great wrestler, great technician. He had that mix of lucha in them. You know, because he wrestled in Mexico, ECW, WCW, WWE, where he became world champion. Mysterio, one of those great luchadors. Hello from wherever you are at. Thank you for tuning in. We've got about 10 minutes, right? 54? Yeah. Less than 10 minutes now. Feel free to ask us questions. We got to figure out something to do on these Monday episodes because these are news filled. These are supposed to be like the news episodes.
Or we'll highlight people that you probably be interested in, depending.
So we gotta find these segments.
But another thing that we noticed too is we've had quite a bit of views from Texas. And I mean, if you think about all the different superstars that have come from Texas.
Mm-hmm. Well, we just had a Royal Rumble in San Antonio, Texas, and the Alamo Dome. So I mentioned Shawn Michaels earlier, the great Stone Cold Steve Austin, what was that faction? They were brothers, Von Erichs. Erichs, especially in the 80s.
That was, you know, I know that there's times where there's controversies over, like, different things in wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there was rumors that the family was, like, what, cursed or something?
Yeah, I think every brother died. There's only one that lived. That was
very unfortunate. I think they said it was suicides.
Mm-hmm. Wrestling back in the day was really, really rough, especially in the 70s and 80s.
Wow.
A lot of guys doing drugs. A lot of guys violent. They took that wrestling to as legitimate, I think. As, you know, and sometimes they would really go too far and go over the edge, and unfortunately lost a lot of good talents, a lot of potential, and you know, from suicide or overdoses or some type of self-destruction.
And the Von Erichs, they continue to have been represented in TNA with Lacey.
Yeah, she was there for a little bit. Don't think she did very much.
I mean, well, she was involved with the popular tag team.
The Beautiful People for a little bit. I don't know where she's at. Is she still wrestling now? I mean, I don't know. I don't know if she is. I don't know the legacy of the Von Erichs, where that goes on. I know, is it Carrie Von Erich that was involved in the induction of the Fabulous Freebirds last year? That was really cool. It was in Texas. It was in Texas last year. So, the Von Erichs leaving a lasting legacy. Their feud against the Fabulous Freebirds is still talked about till this day. And so a very, very cool kind of a legacy in Texas. We mentioned Stone Cold Steve Austin, all his feuds with McMahon, The Rock, Triple H. So on against the Authority, pretty much. And so Shawn Michaels, I mean, his legacy with rivalries against Triple H, Jericho, you know, just a couple to name, his time with DX. Booker T, another legendary Texas wrestler, where he was started out as a tag team with his brother as part of Harlem Heat. Where they would go on to win several tag team titles, and then he would go on to win just about every belt under the sun. 5-time WCW champion, US champion, Intercontinental champion, WWE tag team champion, US champion. I don't know if he won the television title, and I think he did in WCW. Booker would go on to win the King of the Ring, the world title in WWE, and so a lasting legacy for Texas natives. Mark Henry made his return at the Royal Rumble, and so Texas has produced a lot of great talents and a lot of great stars.
Welcome, viewers, if you're just tuning in again to Periscope. We continue to, you know, it's a rainy day, so excuse the,
are we freeze. People?
Oh, it's because, you know, the weather, it's
this
frozen
weather
before.
In California has been very weird. I don't like it. It's been raining, which is good. It's good. But, Yeah, I was not expecting rain today.
Yeah.
Especially when I had to kind of walk and wait for my bus. The good news is there's Monday Night Raw tonight. And there's a lot to look forward to. It's WrestleMania season.
Oh, yeah.
And we've got a couple minutes left.
It's, if you guys would tell us what promotions you watch, where are you guys from?
Yeah, let us know what you guys want us to talk about, because we'll do it. We have plenty of freedom here on Beyond the Ropes to discuss many things. Our recap show is on Wednesday, so we're a little tight on time there. But, I mean, we have plenty of time on Mondays. And so, yeah, like, let us know what you would like to do. Maybe we'll figure something out. But our viewers are, whatever we can get our viewers or listeners, we are on SoundCloud.
Yep.
And so, you know, whatever we can get, we're on YouTube, Facebook, Go Like Our Page. You can follow me at EthanEnvy95 on Twitter. I might be live tweeting tonight. Oh, kind of difficult. I might be getting late, so I'll try and at least live tweet a little bit for Monday Night Raw, but we'll have to figure that out.
Did you DVR it? Or?
I DVR it, so I would start it from the beginning, but I would be behind. So we'll see. We'll see how that goes. Can't really live tweet during pay-per-views because I use my phone to watch on the WWE Network, and so it's hard to do that unless I use my computer. So I may start doing that to get some fan interaction. I might be doing stuff on their Facebook page to get a little more. Got to change that cover photo again.
Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you for tuning in. We're just about heading out, so a couple minutes. Feel free to ask us anything. Let us know where you're from. We want to know where you're from. We're very fascinated by our listeners and viewers from all over the world. So please do so.
You know, it's pretty cool. The Wyatt storyline lately has been very interesting. It's, you never would have expected Randy to have been a member.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's part of that divide and conquer type of thing of splitting up the Wyatt family, which is working very well in Orton's favor. He's now going to main event Mania, and he's going after that title, and at the same time, he's splitting up the Wyatt family. I don't know. That seems to be good for him. Whether or not that's the original plan or not, but it seems like he was intending to split them up. Regardless, it appears that that might happen if Wyatt wins the title at Elimination Chamber. Yeah, I don't know. A lot of speculation going on.
It would be interesting if... What if, although Bray wins the belt all of a sudden at the Chamber, Orton challenges at WrestleMania in a losing effort, and then it's a thing where Bray just feels like everybody's abandoned him, and the only thing that matters is the title. And then it's kind of where he imagines Abigail, Sister Abigail, finally.
That'd be interesting. That's actually a very good storyline, I would think, that would get really get something out of it. I wouldn't want to see Wyatt lose again.
Yeah.
He's lost like 3 years. He's lost twice, and then last year he lost. I mean, it was a match, but he was in that segment with The Rock. And so, I mean, it would be great to see Wyatt win and hold that title for finally after the last couple of years. We are just about out of time now.
What do you think about that story? There was this one story in TNA. I didn't get to follow it thoroughly, but there was a time where in The Beautiful People, Angelina was seeing Winter, but only she could see her.
I don't recall. I remember something like that, but I don't remember the storyline exactly or how it went.
Yeah, it was really something.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she would see her supposedly through a mirror.
Oh, okay. I remember something like that. I remember, like, she was kind of splitting up the beautiful people.
Yeah.
There, so it's very similar. We've seen that kind of stuff, you know, everywhere now. That storyline is not very new necessarily, but it's good to see them rehash it with the wife.
If WWE was to pull that with Sister Abigail, too. Or
that'd be very cool. And we're out of time. 54 minutes, right? Yeah. Yeah, we're out of time, unfortunately. So go give us a like on Facebook. We are live on Periscope Mondays and Wednesdays. Search up Cerritos College around 11 o'clock. And so I'm Ethan.
I'm Rob.
And this has been Beyond the Ropes. We are tapping out. Ring the bell.
All right.